Hello, I'm Ron Ketelsen and I'm president of the Sharon Historical Society. I'd like to welcome you to our program, They May Just Have Found James Tenner's Legs and Other Stories, brought to you by Pete Lindemann. We're excited to have Pete with us tonight, and we have quite a lineup of programs coming up in the next several months, and we'll talk about that a little bit more at the end. But Pete, go ahead and take it away.
My name is Pete Lindemann. I live in Cobleskill, New York, and I work at the Times Journal newspaper as a proofreader and historian. I started working there 3.5 years ago after retiring from the New York State Assembly, where I worked for 33 years. So it's a lot easier making the commute to Cobleskill as opposed to driving into Albany every day. I started writing articles for the Times Journal on a regular basis soon after I started working there. The first one appeared July 4th, 2018, and it had this opening sentence: "They may have just found James Tanner's legs." I liked that sentence so much, I decided to use it as a title for my upcoming book, and I'll explain that title in that article towards the end of my presentation. So the book is going to be a collection of articles that I've written about local history, most of which have appeared in the Times Journal. So for the next 35 to 40 minutes or so, I'm going to talk about 12 of those articles, some unpublished, some not yet written, and end with the one about James Tanner and his legs. But first, let me get a plug in here. We have a local history group, and everyone is invited to participate if you'd like to. We started this right at the beginning of the pandemic in April of 2020, and we meet on Zoom every Friday at 4:30. And if you're interested, my email is right there on the screen, padre.lindemann@gmail.com. Just send me an email and ask me to invite you on, and I certainly will. And what we do is we get together for 40 minutes on Friday afternoons at 4:30 and discuss local history. There's no officers, there's no dues, there's no official records other than a recap that I write up and send out the next morning. So it's a lot of fun. And if you're working on anything, you'll feel free to come on and talk about it. Or if you have questions you want to ask the group, please do so. And it's a really great program. So send me an email if you want to do that. Let's start with a 40-second clip from a movie.
Oh, what's the school that we would do or die for?
Why is Cobleskill High?
Cobleskill High.
Cobleskill High.
Cobleskill High. What's the school that we are aiming high for?
Why is Cobleskill High?
Cobleskill High.
Cobleskill High.
Cobleskill High. We'll fight and fight with all our might until we finally score. When the going's rough, then we'll get tough and fight a whole lot more. Oh, what's the school that we will always try for?
Why is Cobleskill High?
Cobleskill High.
Cobleskill High.
Cobleskill High. Gingerbread, pudding bread, rackety sacks. Cobleskill High School is giving the axe. Are we in it? Well, I guess. Cobleskill High School, yes, yes, yes. Yeah, yeah.
So discovering this movie was a bit of serendipity. One of my jobs at the Times Journal, besides being a proofreader, is compiling the Times Past, where we look back at old articles.
Oh, what's the school that we...
And I came across this article from January 30th, 1947, and it talks about the girl from Cobleskill, and the movie is I'll Be Yours. So I went to a great website. If you've never been there, it's a great website, nyshistoricnewspapers.org, a free website, and that happens to have the Cobleskill Index there from 1865 to 1945. Most issues are there. There's some missing, as with most newspaper websites, but you can do a search, a word search there, and find things that you never could find before by browsing. So I found this ad for the movie, and there it was again, the girl from Cobleskill. So was the actress Deanna Durbin, was she from Cobleskill? Well, in the movie, the actress Deanna Durbin, who is actually from Canada, plays Louise Ginglebusher. leaves Cobleskill to hit it big in New York City. There she goes to see fellow Cobleskill High alum, Mr. Buckingham. And we saw them in that little clip. And together they sing their old alma mater, or at least the Hollywood version. And yes, they pronounce it Cobleskill every time. The article was in the February 24th TJ, and I started it this way. The girl from Cobleskill was born in Winnipeg, Canada. I also like the opening bit in this next article. Atop Roman's nose, looking out over the Schoharie Valley, Irving Langmuir helped win World War II. On June 24th, 1942, the General Electric scientist who had won the Nobel Prize for Chemistry in 1932 with a contingent of Army brass watched from the Middleburg summit as Junior filled the valley with smoke. In 1940, the Army was worried that the Germans would use poisonous smoke. Gas masks worked against gas, but not against smoke. In order to test a mask that could filter smoke, Langmuir and his assistant, Vincent Schaefer, had to build a device that could generate smoke consisting of a particle size difficult to filter and therefore likely to be used by the enemy. They spent a year on the project developing a smoke generator that could produce particles of a uniform size. Then in 1941, it was learned that the Germans were using smoke screens for their industrial plants. The call went out to the scientific community for the creation of smoke screens that could make objects on the ground invisible to the enemy aircraft. Langmuir already knew that light scattering was a factor of particle size, and he and Schaefer already had a machine that could generate smoke of a given particle size. So Langmuir and Schaefer had a smoke generator even before the Army knew it wanted one. Now, this would not have happened without the laissez-faire atmosphere of the GE lab. At a GE colloquium in 1952, Irving Langmuir brilliantly distilled an elusive compound, freedom.
Therefore, you can't predict ideas. That's what freedom's for. That's why we're all so interested in freedom. Is because through freedom, you can do things that you never could do through planning. That's why we're going to beat out in Russia in the long run. Russia believes that everything can be planned. Marx believes that everything could be planned. That's the trouble with all the dictators, that they think that they can run the world by planning from above. It's an utter impossibility. The moment you see that the world isn't the kind of a place where planning, complete planning is possible, then you believe in democracy, you believe in freedom, in initiative, opportunities. What did Mussolini try to do? What did Hitler try to do? They had plans for conquering the world, and they knew just how to do it. They failed. Now in the laboratory, we have a good example. I think most of us here have ideas of freedom and of the importance of thinking things out in your own way. Curiosity, the human virtues, that is curiosity, initiative, interest in things, that is just doing it for the fun of things. That to me is one of the things that you realize in this laboratory. And if it could only be done on a worldwide scale, we would be much better off than we are now.
The next one we'll call the case of the hard-boiled bachelor. Last January, I was at home researching an article on the old store Lambert, Snyder, and Warner, prompted by the exposure of their sign over Chieftain's Restaurant on Main Street in Cobleskill. I learned that the store opened in 1927, then sold out in 1929 to the J.J. Newberry Company. So while the firm of Lambert, Snyder, and Warner lasted only 2 years, their sign has lasted 92. A few hours later, I was at my desk at the Times Journal office when the phone rang in the newsroom. A woman from Syracuse was on the other end. She had found in the bottom of an old trunk a folded up typewritten list. It was addressed to my daughter, entitled 10 Rules for Hard-Boiled Bachelors. It had only the first 6 rules. The second page was missing. Here's rule number 1. Thou shalt not commit thyself. Say it with flowers, but never, never in writing. And it was on letterhead. Lambert, Snyder, and Warner. Just like that, a genuine whodunit had been dropped over the transom. A history article had now become a mystery story. Which partner, Lambert, Snyder, or Warner, was guilty of the anti-marriage diatribe? Turns out it was probably George Snyder. I ended my article this way. Fortunately, since the last 4 rules for hard-boiled bachelors are lost to history, the institution of marriage remains safe and sound. Here's an article I wrote that never appeared in the paper, but I really like it. I wrote it in late March of 2020, just as the pandemic hit. It starts this way. Schoharie County finally cracked the top 10. Granted, we're talking about the most sparsely populated counties in New York State. But in these days of social distancing, less is more. We are number 54 out of 62 New York State counties in terms of population density. Flipped on its head, we become number 9 on the sparsity scale. Now, Schoharie County has 31,420 people in a land area of 621.82 square miles. Let's put that into perspective. A football field is 360 feet by 160 feet, yielding an area of 57,600 square feet. A square mile is 5,280 feet by 5,280 feet for an area of 27,878,400 square feet. I'm beginning to understand now why this article was never published. This means there are 484 football fields in a square mile. So, New York County, Manhattan, the state's tiniest county, would hold 11,050 football fields. On each field would be positioned. ...151 Manhattanites on each football field. As for Schoharie County, there'd be just one of us roaming 9.5 football fields.
How many seas must a white dove sail before she sleeps in the sand? How many times must the cannonballs fly before they're forever banned? The answer, my friend, blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
I once sang with Peter Yarrow. It was at a protest in a park. I remember it was the first day of summer. I had a scraggly beard then and hadn't had a haircut since winter. It was this past Saturday morning. On the chorus, the answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind. Peter Yarrow told the audience to sing along. By a big break, I sang low enough so no one else could hear me, but loud enough to be able to say, I sang with Peter Yarrow.
The answer is blowing in the wind.
At some point, I realized that a good article is a good story, and a good story has to have a hero. I had heard that there was an effort in the mid-1800s to carve up Schoharie County and create a new county called Harrison County. So I wrote my article about the man behind the movement, Zadock Pratt. I started it this way. Zadock Pratt was a builder. He built the largest tannery in the world. For its employees, he built the town of Prattsville around it. At age 59, Pratt decided to build his own county. In 1849, a bill was introduced in the state assembly that would cleave from Schoharie County the towns of Blenheim, Conesville, Gilboa, and Jefferson. They would be joined by Middletown and Roxbury from Delaware County, and Ashland, Lexington, Prattsville, and Windham from Greene County. In the new county of Harrison, the distances to the county seat of Prattsville would be, quote, in all cases but two, from 6 to 12 miles, and in these two cases do not exceed 16 miles. This is based on the idea, of course, that a county seat should be within a horseback ride from anywhere within the county, so that people within the county can do business and not be overburdened. The assembly committee considered the bill and then concluded this, quote, there must always be some towns upon the borders of a county, and it would be impossible to bring every man within a few miles of his county seat without more than doubling our present number of counties. The committee rejected the application, handing Zadock Pratt a rare failure as a builder, and left our county and its 16 towns intact. On April 6th, we will mark the 225th anniversary of Schoharie County, one county, indivisible. Almost exactly 1 year ago, I interviewed World War II vet Ray Fernandez from Cobleskill. Ray was in the Navy from 1943 to 1946 aboard the U.S. Detroit, one of only two ships to be at both the attack on Pearl Harbor and the Japanese surrender. Now, Ray joined in 1943, of course, so he was not on board during the attack on Pearl Harbor, but he was on board for the Japanese surrender, and this is his certificate that he received. I wrote an article with excerpts from the interview, but it was never published. For the book, I may transcribe the entire interview. Here's a 4-minute clip of the interview.
And I've moved 5 times, and it's always been on Barnabelle Road. Yeah.
Why did you join?
Everybody wanted to get in, because what Japan done to us was terrible. So there was no question. And before I got under the Golden Gate Bridge, I was up chucking outside over the deck. I was wondering what I was getting into. Wow. Yeah, I don't know if you want to believe this or not, but the weather was rough, and I was topside, and we knew it was rough, and I had a rope around me, and a wave did hit me, knocked me over. I could have gone over if I didn't have the rope around me. And I was on for 2.5 years. Yeah, you got to be home. Yeah. We had movies in the afternoon. We had boxing matches on top of the ship. And people would gather around there. And that was about it. We done our laundry every day. And I went bowling or roller skating one New Year's Eve in San Francisco. Because everybody went to the bars and stuff, and I didn't participate in that. Yeah. And a lot of times I thought the ship was going to roll over. because we were 55 feet wide and 500 feet long. And we did waves. Sometimes we went directly into the wave. Instead of going down smoothly, you went down like this. And sometimes the propeller would come out of the back end, and that would shake the whole ship. But boy, before I got to the bridge, like I said, I was up chucking because I was wondering what I was getting into. Boy, yeah. And because we didn't hit the bar rooms. One guy stayed on the ship for 2 weeks before he even went on the Liberty because he knew he would get in trouble, go to the bar. And that was it. He just couldn't resist. Well, I think military was good. And I think everybody should have had a little experience in it. Because discipline is the biggest thing. You respected everybody on the ship and you helped each other out and whatnot. Yeah, it was good. I only saw one fellow locally when I was in the service, and that was in San Francisco. I don't know if you remember Don Reynolds or not.
I know.
He lived in Warnerville and he worked at Hell Caverns a long time. And I was crossing the street to go bowling in San Francisco, and he had a shore patrol badge on, and he hollered out, "Hey!" I was scared. And here it was Don Reynolds. And he's the only one I saw locally from the all the time I was in the service.
Wow.
The biggest thing I learned from interviewing people is you have to keep your mouth shut. Once you ask a question, you got to keep your mouth shut because nobody wants to hear you talk. They want to hear the subject talk. So, and I noticed on watching TV interviews that the good interviewer will ask a question and kind of keep shaking his head, but keep his mouth shut. And so I learned that. And that was a very interesting interview with Ray Fernandez, who still lives in Cobleskill. The next article was another bit of serendipity. I was at the Old Stone Fort browsing through the photo notebook of longtime photographer Harold Tolles and came across this entry in the notebook describing a picture. It said, "Socialist Labor Party Petitioners, July 29th, 1950. So I knew that Harold Tolles took pictures in the Cobleskill and Schoharie County area. So I was curious to see why the Labor Party petitioners were in the area. So I got the picture there at the fort, the negative, and I made a positive picture out of it. And there's the picture. So I checked the Cobleskill Times from that time period and found an article entitled "Reds Armed with Petitions Invade Area." So I wrote an article about that. And in the article, I reported the Cobleskill Times article from 1950. And in that article, the petitioners say, "We can prevent another world war. By signing this petition, you can help us achieve this and also aid in bringing about one of the most beneficial social changes this country has ever seen." And then the paper editorializes saying, "These and many other misleading statements were used by two left-wing party workers operating in Schoharie County Saturday. They're required by law to obtain a certain number of names from each county in the state before they can enter their party in the fall election. The tactics employed by these socialistic and probably pro-communist sympathizers range from those of a Coney Island barker to the kind that might be employed by a top flight diplomat. Some of them were characteristic of the soiled shirt, open collar communists, while a few of the solicitors were well-dressed, dignified, and very polite. However, for the most part, well-versed local citizens immediately recognized what they represented and ignored them. When asked what his party, the Industrial Laborites, stood for, he said that they advocated the breaking of the Wall Street monopoly and sought more power for the working class. His party would seek a change in the voting laws so that a person could cast his ballot at his place of employment instead of his district polling place. He said that only 1/6 of the money realized from the sale of goods produced by factory workers is returned to those working people, and his party believes they deserve more. However, he was reluctant to answer the question, if your party is able to do the things you propose and can keep the U.S. from fighting another war, how do you explain the fact that only 4 people have signed your sheet? His answer, the people are not yet educated, but the time is coming. So I thought that was interesting. And what this story does is really tell the story of our national and international history by a local event. In 1950, you had the Red Scare that was started by Senator Joseph McCarthy. And in June of that year is when North Korea invaded South Korea. So right here in Cobleskill, we had a microcosm of events that were taking place across the globe. And that's the way I like to treat history, by looking at local events, because you can tell the big stories by through the little stories that take place right here and in your own community. The next article I wrote to mark the 100th anniversary of the community library in Cobleskill. So again, I needed a hero, a person to tell the story, and the person that I found was John Van Schoik. From Cobleskill, who was commissioner to Belgium for Red Cross during World War I, and was instrumental when he returned in starting up the Cobleskill library. And he said something very interesting in one of the books that he wrote after the war. He talked about the fact that he worked while he was with the Red Cross to provide books to the soldiers. And Van Schoik said, the war itself was waged by engineers and chemists and mechanics of one kind or another. Every shell fired meant intricate calculations and computations. They saw that knowledge was power, and power was life and victory. So we got books and we followed the books up. Some were found in pillboxes, and some were torn, and some were soaked with blood, but they did their job. And this next line is a great line that he says, like the dead horses and blinded horses and wounded dogs and broken automobiles, the wounded books helped hold the line. They were part of the preparedness for peace begun in war. And by keeping up morale, they helped win the war. Van Schoik later became noted for leading the Sunday services at the Beards Hollow Church, which continue to this day. And there's actually a neat little clip of him, 10-second clip I have here, taken in 1940. There was a local See Yourself in the Movies, it was called, a group that came around and filmed local communities after they had an agreement with a local club. In this case, it was the Exchange Club. And then the Exchange Club charged 25 cents to show these movies and presumably paid the film company for submitting it. So here's Van Schoik. This is how I started that article for John Van Schoik. It was personal. And here's Van Schoik here. There he is, John Van Schoik. And that's the idea, this library, which he was so instrumental in bringing about, which this year celebrates its 100th anniversary. And here's Van Schoik right in the middle. This is I move this up here. Here we go. This is something I submitted into Jim and Patsy. Jim is the publisher, Patsy's the editor, and I don't think they knew what to do with it. And I just like it. It's 8 lines, and I'm gonna throw it out here. It's called "If Keats Had Seen the Brooks Chicken Sign Instead of That Old Grecian Urn." Thou still uneaten bird of flightlessness, faster chicken of noble neon. What mad pursuit, what supper to escape, what clucks and footfalls, what wild eatery. Silly chef, never, never canst thou chop, though chasing near the goal. Yet do not grieve. Though she cannot fry, nor canst thou have her breaded, forever wilt thou chase, and she be unbeheaded. I had fun with that one. Here's an article I wrote about the influenza pandemic of 1918. I had been researching World War One on the anniversary of World War One. Our entry was in 1917. And so I had been 4 years ago, I was researching that. And when you research World War One, you can't but research also the what's called at that time the Spanish flu, because it was such a big part of the cause of death of so many soldiers, more so probably than any other cause. So I looked back on influenza, because this was March 18th of 2020, which is right at the very beginning of the pandemic. And what was on everybody's mind was, okay, we have this pandemic. How long is this going to last? So I looked back and I thought, well, we can use the history of the pandemic to maybe get an idea of what to expect. So one thing I did was looked at how many times the words influenza and pandemic and things like that appeared in the paper. So my article started out by saying influenza raged through Cobleskill in the pages of the Cobleskill Index in October 1918. Then as quickly as it flared up, it burned itself out. In the Cobleskill Index, the word influenza did not appear a single time in the period January to September 1918. In October of 1918, it appeared 89 times, peaking at 30 in the October 17 issue. The next month, the total dropped to 83. On October 3rd, 1918, for the first time, the index reported on the influenza, calling it a serious epidemic, a dreaded disease, and warning that it spreads rapidly. And then October 10th, they reported that the Spanish influenza was now spread to practically every part of the country. And the index said, though, while the condition in Cobleskill is not alarming, our town has had its share of influenza patients. The high school and all public places are open as usual. Physicians urge residents to go to bed and keep perfectly quiet for a few days. And by doing so, no serious results seem to follow the attack. Physicians state that about 400 are suffering either from the malady or severe colds in Cobleskill and vicinity. On October 17th, it was reported fewer cases of influenza in Cobleskill than a week ago, and worst believed to be over, and schools and churches may reopen in about 10 days. But the worst was not quite over. It was reported that undertakers as well as physicians have been busy men, undertaker Berger having officiated at 5 funerals during a single day. And then October 24th, 1918, the index reported that while scores of residents in Cobleskill and vicinity are suffering from influenza, local physicians seem to feel that the disease is on the decline and may have passed. The case hereabouts continued to yield readily to treatment where sanitary conditions are good and physician orders are carefully followed. And it concludes this way, yet the conditions are bad enough to make one long for the day when the disease has burned itself out, as it has in other places, and we can feel that the horror of the epidemic has drifted away. This is one of the panels from a cartoon of Mutt and Jeff, and it refers to a macabre poem that was popular at the time. The poem went like this: I had a little bird, its name was Enza. I opened the window and in flew Enza. So here we see, which one is that? Mutt, is that the little guy? He's saying, I went home last night and opened the window and in flew Enza. And he's taking quinine there. So that's a reference to that poem that was popular at the time. I'm going to talk about James Tanner's legs. Then I have one little thing I saved for the very end that I thought would be appropriate to end with after this. The article that began, they may have just found James Tanner's legs, was inspired by an article that was in the Washington Post June 20th of 2018, saying the bones of Civil War dead found on battlefield tell their horror stories. And what happened was in Manassas, Virginia, where the Second Battle of Bull Run took place, they discovered a surgeon's pit, which apparently was the first time they had uncovered a surgeon's pit on a battlefield, and it contained amputated limbs. And James Tanner, who is from Richmondville in Schoharie County, lost his lower legs at the Second Battle of Bull Run, and he had him amputated there. So it's true to say that they may have just found James Tanner's legs. It's highly unlikely that those were James Tanner's legs, but I thought it was interesting that the only time they found the surgeon's pit was at a battlefield where one of our local soldiers lost both his lower legs. James Tanner was discharged from the service after losing both lower legs to amputation, almost died, but survived, came back to Richmondville, and then he attended the Ames School in Syracuse, where he learned standard phonography, which is shorthand. He then got a job in the Ordnance Department in Washington, D.C., and later wrote a book, little pamphlet about his experiences at the Second Battle of Bull Run, experience of a wounded soldier at the Second Battle of Bull Run. While in Washington, he happened to be boarding next to the Peterson House on the night of April 14th, 1865. He was at a play, not Our American Cousin, but Aladdin's Lamp, which was at Grover's Theater. And then someone came on stage and said that the president's been shot. Everybody stood up and started to move around. Somebody else stood up and said, no, it's probably just a ruse of the pickpockets. He said, it's probably not true. So they sat back down. And then the manager of the theater came out and confirmed that, yes, the president had been shot. So, of course, everybody streamed out of the theater down to Ford's Theater. And Tanner roomed right next to the Peterson House, where the fallen president had been carried. They were interviewing in the Peterson House, in the room next to the room where Lincoln lay dying, interviewing witnesses from Ford's Theater. And they were trying to take down depositions, but if anyone's tried to do that, it's not an easy thing to do. So the call went out to someone who knew shorthand. And one of the officers there knew that James Tanner, who was then only 21 years old, knew shorthand. So he called James Tanner in, and James Tanner was allowed to pass through into the room, outside the room where the president lay dying. He took the deposition down in shorthand. He was so nervous that he was sure that he would not be able to read it back later, but he did. He wrote it out in longhand, and then James Tanner says that after he wrote it out in longhand, he passed into the room where Lincoln lay dying. And here's a representation of Corporal Tanner at Lincoln's deathbed, which is on a quilt showing all the towns in Schoharie County. And for Richmondville, their claim to fame, and it truly is a claim to fame, is that James Tanner was President Lincoln's deathbed. Of course, there was a whole group of people at Lincoln's deathbed, but this shows just James Tanner at Lincoln's deathbed. When the president expired at 7:20 a.m. on April 15th, 1865, the president's minister, Reverend Phineas Gurley, said a prayer. And James Tanner recalled later that Reverend Gurley spoke in a very slow, deliberate tone, so it would have been very easy to record that prayer. So he reached into his pocket to get his pencil to take down the prayer in shorthand, but his haste defeated his purpose, and he broke the point of his pencil and never recorded the prayer given by Phineas Gurley. Now, interestingly, James Tanner is reported to have been there at Lincoln's deathbed. There are drawings done, paintings done. James Tanner, as far as you know, is not in any of them. There are accounts of the deathbed scene. And as far as we can tell, this is an ongoing item in our local history group. The only one who puts James Tanner at Lincoln's deathbed is actually James Tanner. So we're not sure if he was actually there or not. He certainly did take deposition, the book that he took it down in, he donated to the Union League of Philadelphia, and you can, it's called As Lincoln Lay Dying, and you can read that book online and read what the witnesses said. So he certainly was there. Whether he passed into the other room is the question, and we're not sure that that happened or not. But the idea being that James Tanner, who went on to become the commander-in-chief of the Grand Army of the Republic and commissioner of wills in Washington, D.C., and quite a promoter and fan of Cobleskill. He always, when he came back, he always spoke highly of Cobleskill. He stayed at the Hotel Augustine when he came back, and is quite famous in our area for being present at Lincoln's deathbed. So this is the article that appeared that from which I got the title, and the opening line is, they may have just found James Tanner's legs. The last time I did this presentation, we had a forensic archaeologist here and was wondering for more information on that, and I'm sorry I wasn't able to provide anything on that. The last bit I have here is interesting, and this is a clip from an old movie that we found in the Cobleskill storage shed. Mark Sullivan, who I think might be on with us for this meeting, kind of honchoed that thing and got that organized. We conducted an inventory of the storage shed, which contains items of historic interest owned by the town of Cobleskill. And in there, we found some old film. And so I had that film digitized, and I had to send it off to New York City, but we finally got it back. And it's not a long film. It looked to me like it was going to be a long film because it was a whole roll of film. And when I brought it in to the local place in Gilderland before they sent it off, they said, oh, and that's only a few minutes of film. They could tell just by looking at it based on the feet of film. Anyway, this film contains this short little clip in here, and it's from the 1927 sesquicentennial celebration held at the Cobleskill Fairgrounds. The what threw me off at first was 1927 sesquicentennial. Okay, 1927 minus 150 is 1777. What the state historian wanted local communities to commemorate in 1927 was their local involvement with the Revolutionary War, because even though the Declaration of Independence, of course, was 1776, it wasn't until 1777 that New York State became involved, and there was battles fought in New York State. So it was meant to commemorate those things. So Cobleskill took it to heart. Chauncey Rickert wrote a pageant, and that's what was put on in 1927. So there's this short clip here, and it's described this way in the newspaper. This scene is called Victorious America, and it's described this way in the Cobleskill Times. The entire pageant cast, numbering nearly 200, were assembled for the final scene, Victorious America. The defeated forces are seen crouching before Uncle Sam in the spirit of liberty, with Washington receiving the sword of the vanquished. The audience cheered enthusiastically at this presentation, with the fife and drum corps and Berger's Band of Troy alternately accompanying the stirring finale. That's from the Cobleskill Times of August 18, 1927. Now, of course, there's no sound, so this is about 15 seconds, and then I'm going to show you I added sound to it. So here it is first without sound. So then I added some sound effects, and by doing so, I think it really captures the moment that the cameraman captured the enthusiastic response from the audience. And for some reason, it cuts off there. And that concludes my presentation on They May Have Just Found James Tanner's Legs and Other Schoharie County Articles by Pete Lindemann.
So while we're waiting for any questions that might come in, there's Pete's email address again, and we'll tell you about a couple of other things that are going on. And feel free to to type in the questions. While we're waiting, I'm going to show you just one other thing. There's been a lot of questions that have come up. As you know, these programs are sponsored by the Sharon Historical Society, and we are doing some really amazing things this year with the Historical Society. We went from publishing one newsletter a year to five, and we used to have about six programs a year. This year we're doing 15 through Zoom. Next year we're doing two programs a month, so there'll be 24. There'll be one that'll be local and the other one will be through Zoom. And then our membership is just kind of has really skyrocketed. We went from six lifetime memberships to 27. We went from 24 individual members to 76. We have a new book coming out by Sandy Manco called The Many Fires of Sharon Springs. We are reprinting some of the books that we have had in the past. We did a display at the Sunshine Fair this year. And the biggest news is that we're beginning a museum expansion project, which is really going to be exciting. Our programs have been attended by people from over 50 states and 14 foreign countries. We've been really surprised that they're picking it up in, as you can see here, Scotland, Switzerland, Barbados, Australia. And so we've really had a lot of interest. And as I mentioned, our expansion project, we're undertaking a pretty aggressive expansion project. And we're going to be adding to the museum and trying to purchase some land next door and make little vignettes into each of those buildings that are currently there. And phase two is to add a new addition to the back of the building. We're completely out of space, and we've got a lot of exciting things that are coming up. So we definitely want to continue to expand. And so we're going to work on that. The other thing that I wanted to mention is that people have been asking, how do they see the other presentations that have been done? And you can go on to YouTube and you can see the presentations. It's really interesting. We did a presentation on the history preserved in quilts, and we put that on our YouTube channel. It's been viewed over 6,000 times since it's been on YouTube. And we just did one on the Adler Hotel from heyday to present day, and just since it aired, there's been almost 1,000 views on that. So it's really amazing. Pete, I've got some questions for you. So any local stories you hope to tell but don't have the background for?
Actually, there is one. Yeah, I'm working on a presentation. Saturday I was invited to the Donuts Brow, which is a condominiums in Cobleskill. It's called Donuts Brow, and I'm going to speak there about veterans, but I want to talk a little bit about Donuts Brow. Donuts Brow was on Donuts Mountain, D-O-N-A-T apostrophe S, and in the Cobleskill school song, they talk about under old Donuts Brow, and that's where the name comes from. But I haven't been able to figure out where Donuts Mountain, where that name comes from. And I'm thinking that Donuts Brow is a guy that started with the alma mater. In other words, they're talking about Donuts Mountain and they're right underneath it. So they're saying under Donuts Brow. So I'm working on that. And what I'm going to be talking about there is for the veterans, I decided that I would talk about the fact that there are from Schoharie County, some recipients of the Medal of Honor. There are actually four. Two from the Civil War, one from the Indian Wars, and one from the Spanish-American War. So I'm going to be talking about those. So Donuts Mountain and Donuts Brow is something I need to find out more information. And I'm sure there's a lot more stuff that I still don't know, but I can't think of right now.
Pete, can you mention the name of the website again that people can search for newspapers? Someone's asking
yes.
If you would.
Yes. Yes, it's all one word, of course, nyshistoricnewspapers.org, nyshistoricnewspapers.org. And you can just Google that or put that into the search engine there and you'll come up with that. It's a great website that you'll pop up with a map of New York State with all the counties and click on the county you want. And for Cobleskill, you'll get the Cobleskill Index, and that's about it, I think. There's not much else in Cobleskill, but the nice thing is the search engine on there.
Mark Sullivan's asking about a program on Jack Daniels' book.
Yes, Jack Daniels was a local peace activist, the late Jack Daniels, and also very interested in African-Americans in Schoharie County, and wrote a book called The Forgotten History of African-Americans in Schoharie County, which is basically a series of articles he wrote for the Schoharie County Historical Review. And he raised a lot of questions, and the Old Stone Fort received a grant of some equipment, and with the idea that they would use that equipment, technical equipment, computers, things like that, to tell the stories of marginalized and underreported peoples in the area. And one of those are the Black Americans in Schoharie County. So there's a series of workshops that we're conducting. There's one coming up next week. If you go to the Old Stone Fort website, you'll see that. Mine is on December 16th, and I'll be talking about a newspaper that came out called the Freeman's Expositor, which reported on a meeting in 1845 of a group of Black Americans on Spring Street in Schoharie, at which time they chose a slate of Black American candidates for local office. However, the report of the election shows none of the candidates listed, and there's a mystery on whether the meeting actually took place and who actually was the reporter that wrote it. And so it's a very interesting topic. If you go to the Old Stone Fort website, you'll find all that information on there about those programs.
Okay. Well, that's what I have in the way of questions for you. Again, there's Pete's email address. If you would like to reach out to Pete, you can email him here. Our next program coming up on November 22nd is Assassination of John F. Kennedy, 58 Years Later. That will be on November 22nd at 7 p.m. I had mentioned that we have a number of programs coming up next year, just trying to let you know what some of those are. How to tell the history of your house. There's the Underground Railroad was extremely popular this year, so we're doing a program on Harriet Tubman and the Underground Railroad. We're doing one on how to reglaze and preserve vintage windows, the life and times of President Abraham Lincoln. Our hotel series has been very popular, so we're going to be doing program on the story of the Roseboro Hotel and also the Pavilion Hotel, which were our two hotels here in Sharon Springs. We're also doing another Americans quilting history, quilt styles, and quilting myths. There's a story on Monticello, the home of Thomas, or a program on Monticello, the home of Thomas Jefferson. The notorious Ruth Bader Ginsburg, the life and times of Ruth. We've got Amish life in Schoharie County. So that's just a few of the programs. There's many, many more that are coming up. And so those will be announced as we go along. And I will show you how you can, let's see here. If you are watching this program, you're going to receive emails about all of the programs that will be coming up the rest of this year and next year. And there's the information. If you are wanting to reach out to the Sharon Historical Society, feel free to do that. Again, I'd like to thank Pete Lindemann for his program tonight. It was a great program, and we want to thank all of you for participating. So we look forward to seeing you at our next program.